Among the many hats that you wear at BBC Worldwide, one of your major responsibilities is the global iPlayer. Can you tell us a bit about your vision for the future of on-demand content and broadcasting?
Yes, I think the iPlayer project is it's a sort of way of giving directly to consumers a lot of choices that they might not get on our linear channels, which we also think are great. But we think that actually the app, which is being developed for the iPad, will be able to give you a sort of a set of journeys you can take between different genres of programming from, factual, current affairs, fiction, comedy, short form potentially even in the future. You could make it sort of like your own customized magazine of different types of media choices about the best of British and the best of the BBC. So I suppose a vision I have for that is that you have a lot of people being given the kind of tools to take a journey to really find out and bump into surprising content and programs they just didn't really know that they'd like. So the whole purpose of broadcasting in a way is to introduce new things. This is introducing both the new in terms of international markets and some favorites as well, which would be kind of the hooks of familiar titles or familiar faces. So we are hoping that it's kind of like a giant world. In your own right, you can find your world of different types of media choices for great British content.
Great. And you've just announced that the iPlayer will be launching in Western Europe. How will it differ there from the iPlayer currently available in the UK?
Well, the idea of this BBC iPlayer, the global version, is that it isn't really tied to any linear schedules because there aren't the schedules, there aren't the channels there to be related to your program choices. So while the UK, the British BBC iPlayer, is catch up, a 7 days catch up of all the programs in those schedules, pretty much across everything from children's to BBC One. The we're really not tied to that, nor could we do it in Europe. So in Europe, it's going to be a kind of an English language, but customized for both archive, kind of treasure trove of different types of archive, but also just great programs organized much more around groups that would be recognizable, like let's say drama or comedy, recognizable whether you have a linear schedule there informing you or not. So it's independent of the BBC iPlayer from the point of view of not being a catch-up service, but being an editorialized product.
And you're known for having been an early champion of online strategies in broadcasting. I'm wondering if there was an aha moment for you when you first realized that digital media would be so central in the future.
Well, because in my early part of my career, I was became head of BBC Science, and therefore I was around a lot of technologically sophisticated people, much more than me, and they were early people to break down this kind of BBC firewall, which is a sort of you're not meant to let people in, and they created a science website, and it was one of the earliest websites in the BBC, except for news, and the BBC was very early in the news area, and so that was one. The other was sitting on a plane and reading an article about eBay. I was in the States and read this article and thought, that is a genius idea. This idea of this trading going on. At that time, it was just upstairs above a, I don't know, a garage or something. These eBay people had come up with this great idea. Little did anybody, I mean, I didn't ever imagine, I don't know how many other people did, that that would become the eBay of today. But I went back to the UK after that trip. And I just said to everybody, you've got to think of the web as far more than just a publishing medium. It is just so, there's so much more inherently possible because of the two-way nature of it. And I just thought we've got to think of all the different possibilities that this might offer. And then the third wave for me was thinking of how can you make much more of just a simple, even a great television program can live on way beyond its single transmission moment because you can build output to enhance it, which you wouldn't necessarily put in a linear set schedule because that's a very constrained, time-limited thing, literally. So then the idea of building out much more of what's in the mind and the of a production team. They know so much more than they're ever putting into the program. What else should we make of it? And I've really sort of thought of how do you encourage those broader ways of thinking and creativity involved in that, which it's a very exciting time. I still think there's still much more to in sort of explore and invent there.
Look where you are now. Finally, a lot of your colleagues annually make the trip across the pond to attend the Banff World Media Festival. What do you think it is about Banff that keeps the Brits coming back?
I was going to say it's the clear air and the beautiful mountains and the company, but I think it's a kind of unique kind of festival in that there's a lot of different groups here, from whether it's gaming now, you know, there's an interesting gaming panel at Banff this year, there's co-production conversations, there's regulatory conversations about, you know, what to do in this new thing about OTT over the top. There's interesting engagement of all sorts of aspects of the industry, and it's also very international, which is also a hallmark of Canadian thinking, I think. It's kind of inviting people in. So it's sort of that, so it's got a great, it's a less high pressure thing than a market, yet quite a lot of business gets done. So that's why I think it's quite successful, because you can come here with and do lots of different things, which together are very sort of energizing.
Great, thank you so much.